Good morning, everybody. We very much appreciate all of you making it to a 9 a.m. session the day after all the parties. So we appreciate your dedication there. The title of this talk is Mesos and OpenStack, the perfect tag team for containers. If you look at the world the way we look at the world, you've got OpenStack, which obviously huge amount of interest and lots of wonderful IaaS capabilities. And if you also see what's happening in the world, these container things popped up and a huge amount of interest there. And to make things even more interesting, you know, the container story is one that has different facets: Swarm, Kubernetes, Mesos. So what we're talking about in this presentation is how we're taking that world with those pieces and combining it with OpenStack and our strategies for doing that to get the best of both worlds. And so we're going to look at, you know, how we're providing an environment that's optimized for allowing you to run Swarm and Kubernetes workloads. We're going to talk about how we leverage all the benefits from OpenStack, including Magnum. And if you know Paulo here, he's going to talk about our combined Mesos, Kubernetes, and Swarm architecture. And then after that, Ton's going to show us some demos of where we integrate with OpenStack. And then we'll do a scaling demo. So I'm going to hand over to Paulo.
Thank you. So let's talk first about Swarm. How many people are familiar with Swarm here? Okay. What about Kubernetes? Very good. And what about Mesos? Cool. So anyway, I'm going to talk a bit about these frameworks. I think it's probably good to mention what they do, what are the differences between them. First, let's talk about Swarm. What is Swarm? Essentially, Swarm is a way when you have a number of hosts where you are running Docker, the Docker engine, to expose all of them as a single virtual engine. It provides a standard Docker API. And that is important because you can use the standard Docker tools, for example, Docker Compose, Docker CLI, Jenkins. All these tools will work out of the box and will provide essentially the same familiar experience to Docker developers. So if you're already using Docker for development in your laptop or in your desktop, you essentially have the same experience, right? But Docker Swarm provides the way to schedule containers in different hosts. And looking at the, we have here a very simple architectural chart. Looking here, what we have is there is a Swarm Manager component that connects to a number of Swarm nodes, where each one of them is running the Docker engine. And the manager essentially has two components: the scheduler, that is essentially what it does is to schedule containers on the different hosts based on different criteria, for example, scheduling constraints. And then there is also a discovery component that provides the membership for the different nodes, the membership information to the Swarm Manager, which nodes belong to this particular cluster. So again, it's relatively straightforward, very simple, very lightweight. Let's talk a bit about Kubernetes. Kubernetes is essentially orchestration open source for Docker containers. It was promoted by open source by Google more than a year ago, and is getting some traction in the open source community. It has much more sophistication if you compare with Swarm in terms of capabilities. Essentially, what it does, it provides also the ability to schedule containers on different nodes, but it provides more concepts compared to just Swarm. It provides the concept of pods. What are pods? Pods are essentially a set of containers that are co-located in the same host. They work together. They share resources like a network namespace, for example. And they work together. Imagine a pod can be, for example, a web server and a database working together for building an application. And you can imagine also adding the same pod other containers for things like, for example, logging, monitoring, and additional capabilities that are part of your application. They can be packaged together in the same pod. There is also a notion of replica set, formerly known as replication controllers. Simply, these are kind of scaling groups. It's really a set of pods that homogeneous set of pods that can be scaled up and down, and also provides capability like auto-recovery and auto-scaling. And another notion that we have in Kubernetes is also services. You can imagine a service just a way to essentially associate with the load balancer endpoints that are essentially the pods or the replica sets that you can essentially expose using labels that can be associated with the pods, for example, and the selectors. So this is pretty much the main concept that we have in Kubernetes. There is much more, of course, to talk about Kubernetes probably alone. It will take some time. But I want just to point out that the API for Kubernetes is actually quite different from Swarm, essentially because there are these additional capabilities compared to containers, just Docker containers. For example, you can create pods, you can create replica sets, you can create and manage services. So the API is definitely much more sophisticated and many more capabilities. So let's talk a bit now about Mesos. This is another component that we're going to show in this demo. Mesos is also an open source cluster management system. And the focus here is really on managing resources. One of the main use cases for Mesos is really the ability to consolidate workloads. Imagine that I have, for example, a workload for running Hadoop applications, one for maybe Spark, one for maybe Storm. Here is at least in this example. And normally we run them all in different clusters. Imagine that now I want to share a single cluster and run all these different workloads together. This is pretty much what Mesos allowed me to do, because it provides the ability to manage resources. And by resources, I mean compute, disk, storage, essentially, and CPU. So once basically I deploy Mesos on a cluster, Mesos will provide the resource offers to the different frameworks. Framework is also a terminology used in Mesos. For example, Hadoop working on Mesos is called a framework. And the offer, essentially, the resource offer will provide information like the nodes that are available, what is the CPU available, what is the memory available on these nodes, and the disk available, et cetera. And typically, the framework will have a scheduler to choose on which particular nodes will want to run these resources. So there is some separation of concern between the actual management of the resources and the actual scheduling that is done by that framework. And there are many frameworks in the open source communities that they keep on adding more. And the example we're going to show today is essentially running as a framework Kubernetes and Swarm in this environment. Finally, let's put all together. We talk about Swarm, Kubernetes, and Mesos. Let's see how these things work together. And also with OpenStack, because that's what we really want to show here, is how we leverage OpenStack as well as Mesos, Swarm and Kubernetes in this in this environment. So OpenStack is essentially providing the resources, compute, storage, network, essentially the machines where we're going to run Mesos, and then we're going to run Swarm and Kubernetes on top of Mesos. So the bottom layer you see, we have OpenStack, and we also have Mesos agents in the bottom layer. Each node has a Mesos agent installed, and then there is a Mesos master. Okay, the Mesos agents are essentially getting information on the available resources on each host, and they provide information to the Mesos master that aggregates them and creates what I mentioned earlier as resource offers. So again, a resource offer is a list of hosts, essentially, with the list of available resources like CPU, memory, and disk on each host. And you can have other resources as well, as extensions, for example, ports, if you are using port mapping, or they can be potentially GPUs or other type of resources that can be deployed in those hosts. The Mesos master will send these offers to each framework that is registered with Mesos. For example, it's going to send the offer to Swarm. It's going to send to Kubernetes as well. And now each framework knows pretty much what is available to deploy basically the workload on these resources. So, for example, if we start from Swarm, suppose that there is a request for Swarm to start a container. For example, a Docker run command to start a Docker container on Swarm on Mesos. It's going to go first to a queue here. And then the scheduler is going to pick up the request from the queue. It's going to compare with the offer that was received by Mesos master. And the offer will contain information like, oh, I have like three nodes available, and these are the CPU memory that I can give you. And the scheduler will decide in which particular nodes these containers will be started. It's going to send the request to Mesos master, and Mesos master is going to forward that to the agents in the nodes where these particular containers should start. And it's going to start as a task, as a Mesos task, these Docker containers with essentially the Docker run. And there is a particular component called the Mesos Docker executor that is going to take care of actually starting that container. It's going to also remove that particular resource that has been used, memory, CPU, and disk, by that container from the list of available resources. The same thing happened pretty much on Kubernetes. In Kubernetes, you can imagine this time we're starting pods, so there will be a request coming to the Kubernetes API to create, for example, a new pod. And the request will go again to the scheduler that has also the available resources from Mesos, and it's going to decide where to schedule the particular pod, in which host it should be started. And then it's going to send the request to the Mesos master. Mesos master this time is going to forward to one of the Mesos agents, where if it's not already available, it's going to fetch a kubelet that is essentially the component in Kubernetes that manage the pods in each individual host. And the kubelet will take care of actually starting the pod in the particular selected host. So this is pretty much what happens. And we're going to actually demonstrate this. Tony's going to actually show how we built essentially this this environment and demonstration how this all works together.
All right, thank you, Paolo. All right, so what I'll do next is to show how this whole environment run in OpenStack. Right, so first, how do you deploy it? Right, there are two ways to we can do this. One is by Magnum. It's an OpenStack project. So with Magnum, there's a few prep work we have to do manually. We have to prepare the key pair, the image. And what you do next is create a Bay model. And so in this case, it's going to be a Mesos Bay model. Right? And with that, then we can invoke Magnum to go and create the Bay. So right now, we don't have the support yet for deploying the Kubernetes and Swarm framework, but I'm working on a couple of patches to do this, so we should have that capability pretty soon. Second way is to do this by Ansible script and Shade. So this is actually what we have developed in IBM. And for this, we also have to prepare the key pair, and the image, and the private network to deploy the cluster into. So to describe the cluster to build, we create a little config file, very simple, you know, key value pair to describe what we want to build. And then we run the script. The script would use Shade to talk to OpenStack, and it would go off and deploy the Nova instance and so on. And then it's going to log into each of those instances, install the software prereq, and launch all the container that would provide the service for Kubernetes, Mesos, Swarm, and all the supporting services like etcd and Zookeeper. Right, so the nice thing is that once this cluster is up and running in OpenStack, you interact with the Kubernetes and Swarm through the normal interface, like kubectl or Docker command line. So you know, there's no new interface to be used there. Okay. So let's take a look at the networking side. All right. The way the implementation is right now, the support for networking is still pretty simple. It's pretty basic. We are using the basic host and IP and port mapping. So what it means is that the container would not have its own IP. It would take the IP of the host it's running on, and the port from the container is going to be mapped to one of the ports on that host. We are in the process of integrating Courier. There's a parallel talk on Courier right now. So what Courier does is that for now it's supporting Swarm. So what it does is that it maps the interface from Docker Lab Network to OpenStack. So when you run a Docker command to create a network, Courier would handle the mapping and create the corresponding network in Neutron for you. And what you get back is an ID for your Docker network. And then you would, when you do a Docker run to create your container, you just specify that, you know, put this Docker container on this network that I just created. Right, so with that one, then what you can do is that, you know, you can achieve this kind of any kind of network topology you want to do. You can isolate the container as you wish. And you can even, if you want to, have a Neutron router between them to, if you want to connect in some network. To have this working on the Kubernetes and Mesos, we do need a couple patches in Mesos itself, and these patches are right now under review by the Mesos community. So that's for Swarm, right? Now, for Kubernetes, right now we don't have support yet for the kind of networking. But the Courier team does have a spec to implement the CNI networking for Kubernetes, and that's under review right now. And we expect that the implementation will be be done in the Newton cycle. Right. Now let's take a look at the storage side. Again, similar to networking, right now the implementation is still pretty basic. When we come up, the default is to use host storage, right? So when we create the Nova instance, it's going to come with a certain amount of storage, depending on the flavor that we choose for the instance, right? So the Docker daemon is going to just use that storage to host the container, right? But to manage the storage a little bit more in a more flexible way, then we would want to create cinder block. And with the cinder block, then we can use the storage in two ways. First, we can just use the normal. We can configure the block as logical volume, attach them to the host, and provide the storage to the Docker daemon to host your container. Right, so that's the easiest way, and this is what Magnum is doing right now. So that's this picture here. A second way to use the cinder block is to use it as persistent storage for the container. So for example, if we want to hold a database and make it, you know, survive the container, then you would want to have some kind of persistent storage. And there's a couple of ways to do this. Kubernetes actually provide a plugin for this purpose. So the way it works is that you would create your Docker, your cinder block, and then when you write up your YAML file to describe your pod, you just code that ID for the cinder block in your YAML. And what happens is that when you deploy the pod, then Kubernetes would talk to cinder and tell cinder to mount that block storage to the host where the pod is running, and then, you know, the block storage will be visible to your pod. Okay? So that's how it works. For our case here, where we have Kubernetes running on Mesos, that's not quite working yet, and we're working with the Kubernetes community to try to support this. So that would give you this picture here, where the container is able to use block storage. So looking forward a little bit, the Courier team has expanded their mission so that they will support storage for container as well. And we just found out that there's a new project called Fuji that want to provide support for storage for container. So between the Magnum team, the Kubernetes team, and the Fuji team, we're meeting to at the summit here to kind of hash out how we can collaborate. But this is a pretty active area of work here. So on this chart, we list a number of operations that are not well supported yet for clustering, in particular the Mesos cluster. But we think that when you scale, when you talk about scaling to a very large number of hosts in your cluster, this is the kind of operation that you really need to be able to manage your cluster. So first, you'll be able to have to be able to add, remove node, scale in and scale out. So that's a given. Adding node is not too bad, but removing node might take, you know, require some more care. We might have to think about having to migrate container and so on. So that depends on the orchestration layer. You know, for Kubernetes, maybe it's easier because the part in Kubernetes is ephemeral, so it can die. You can kill it anytime, and it would be recreated somewhere else. But in the other case, we might have to give some more thought about how to vacate a host before we remove it. Networking, whether we saw that the user can, you know, create a private network for their container, so we have to be able to manage those private network, you know, in some nice way. And we want to be able to connect to existing network as well. So if a user come along and then they run some container and they want to connect to their existing network, we have to provide that capability. Right. Same with storage. And we saw about block storage, and, you know, user might come along with some center block that they want to mount and make available to their container. We will be want to be able to support that from the cloud provider, cloud admin kind of view. Hardware is going to fail, so, you know, node is going to die and so on. So we have to be able to manage that. We have to be able to see the health of the cluster on a very large scale. And when you know, something wrong happened, we have to be able to recover from the error. And then software will change also, and they might show up as a patch, hotfix, upgrade, and so on. And it could impact everything from the OS of the node to the Mesos base to the framework themselves, or even the supporting service like etcd or Zookeeper. So we have to be able to handle this kind of a change to the system. Okay, so what I'll do next is show you a quick demo of how this is running on OpenStack. You can kind of get kind of feel of what it looks like. Okay, we do have this environment running in our lab, and I could do a live demo, but we do have a lot of shows, so to make sure that I don't lose time, but typing command and making typo and so on. So what I do is show a recorded video, and I'll pause and explain what's going on. Okay. Okay. So on this screen here, I have a browser on the left side and two terminal screen on the right side where I would run command. Right. So first, we take a look at a simple config file. You know, so here we're running the deployment by using the Ansible script that we developed. So here is the config file to describe the cluster you want to build. Right. So pretty straightforward. You have the size of the cluster, how many worker, how many master, and so on. So pretty straightforward there. So what I'll do now is run the Ansible script step by step, you know, playbook by playbook, so that you can see what's going on. But in normal case, you just, you know, group all these playbook into one, you know, master playbook and run it with one command. So first, we run the playbook to create the VM, right? So what happened here is that the Ansible script used shade to talk to OpenStack, and it's going to launch a number of VM here, and you're going to see it showing up on horizon here. Okay, so here are the three VM that we just launched for this new cluster. So next, we'll run another script to set up the Ansible inventory. This is to tell Ansible how you want to configure your cluster, right? So once it's done, we can take a look at the inventory here. And we see this is how we are going to configure the cluster. So we have out of the three nodes that we just created, one of them is going to be the master, and the other two is going to be the worker, the slave. So this script also set up the host file in the node themselves, because we don't have DNS running in our environment. But if we do have DNS, then we would need that. So next, we'll run another Ansible script. And this is going to log into each of the node to install software prereq for the node before we install Mesos. What we could have done also is to use this image builder and build a custom image with all those packages pre-installed into the image. If we do that, then we don't need to run this step. Right? So just the way we separate now. Okay. Once it's done, now we can deploy Mesos. And this is you can see it's very simple. We run an Ansible playbook, and we just launch a Ansible script to go out and deploy Mesos. So the way Mesos is packaged here is a set of containers. So what the Ansible script is doing is pretty simple. It's just go off and launch those containers for Mesos. Okay. So it should run pretty quick. Right, so it's done. So with the Mesos framework up and running, what we do next is to deploy the framework. So we start with the Kubernetes framework. So again, this is very pretty straightforward, just running a playbook with the script for the Kube framework. And again, the framework here is just a set of containers. So we're just launching container. Okay, so that's the Kube framework. And we do the same for the Swarm framework. And like I said, this is just another set of container and up and running. Okay, right. So now everything is up and running in the cluster. So what I do now is I show you what the resource looks like for this cluster in OpenStack. Right. So here is security group. So what I want to show here is the number of ports that we have open, especially for this cluster, so that the servers can talk to each other. Right. And here's the key pair. This one is a little bit special because of the way Ansible works. Ansible has to be able to log into all the nodes that it managed as root. So the key pair here is prepared using the root IDRSA of the Ansible host that you run from. Here's the bit of the network, and this network we had created manually before we launched the cluster, and it's a private network. And here we have the three nodes that we had created along with a test node that I created earlier. Right, so we have a router here that connects the private network to the public network. This is so that the host and the container can get to the external internet. We do have floating IP also for all the hosts, so that you know we can log in and we can access the endpoint from the container. Right. So this is what the Mesos UI look like. So at this point here, I had already run a number of tasks, so you can see that there's a history of those tasks here, and. If we go to the tab for framework, you see that there are two frameworks running right now. There that we had deployed the Kubernetes framework and the Swarm framework. Okay. If we go to the slave tab, we see that for this cluster we have two slaves, and then these are showing up here. And then we, if we go to the tab for offer, right? So the way Mesos work is that it make a resource offer to the framework. And so here we have we see a number of resource offer that's been already made to the Kubernetes and Swarm framework. And these are for running the tasks that start previously. So right now we don't have any active tasks. So let's go ahead and create a couple container in the cluster. So we start by creating a pod in Kubernetes. So going to Kubernetes, we do a kubectl command to look at a node. Right, so this is what the kube thing is seeing as the node for its cluster. Right, so we see two nodes here. Kube claim that one of them is not ready yet, but that's just we find that there's heartbeat synchronization between the kubelet in the node and the kube API server in the master. And sometimes when it wake up, it takes a little time to become ready. Right, if we do a get pod, there's nothing right now, not running right now. If we do a get service, we see two services running. These are the internal service for Kubernetes. So let's create a pod. There's some running. And so this is what the YAML for that pod looks like. It's a very simple pod. So all it does is that launching this image Nginx here. And it's saying that I want to map the port 80 from that pod out to the outside. So we see on the side here that the task just pop up on Mesos. Okay. Now, for Kubernetes, we can't talk to the pod directly. So to expose the endpoint from the pod from Nginx, we have to launch a service. Right. So this is a service that got launched. It represents the pod. And here is looking for this pod here called app Nginx. And it's going to map the port 80 from that pod out to the external side. Okay. So now the pod is running. And we look at the detail for the pod. We can see that it's running here. And it's running on this host 10.0.100.121. Okay. And if we look at the detail for the service, we see that it's running, it's showing that on this host 10.1.121 is showing up on port 5503. Now we need to go back. So this node here does have the floating point, the floating IP of 9.30.107.181. So now we have to open that port 5503 on this node. We do that. So once we open that port, we can now go to that host with that port, and we see Nginx showing up there. Okay, so that's coming from the container that we just started in Kubernetes. So let's now do the same thing for Swarm. So same thing, with Swarm, you use a Docker command line. Here we do a Docker PS to see what's going on. Nothing going on yet. So we run a Docker run. And here again, we're going to run the Nginx image, and we're going to tell it to map port 80. Right? Same thing. So the Docker Swarm container got launched, and we do PS again, and we see a detail for that container up there. And now we can go back to the Mesos UI. We can see that both of the containers are running. This one is from the Swarm, that we start from Swarm, and this one we started from Kubernetes. Both are running on the Mesos Bay. Okay, so going back to the Swarm container, we see that it's running on this host 121 on this port 15000. Okay, so we do have to map open that port in the security group as well, but I'm not showing that step right now. And then I'm going to do a cur, So what I'm doing now is a little bit different from last time. Last time we accessed the endpoint from the external, so we used the floating IP. But here I'm going to access it from the internal private neutral network. So I'm going to use the internal IP instead, but with the same host 15000. Right, and we get back the page from the internet container. This one is from Swarm. Okay. So without we see that we have a workload running on the same cluster from both from Kubernetes and Swarm. Right. So what I do next is I pass back to Paolo. He'll talk about how to scale.
So we go fast on this one because we are almost out of time. So essentially what we show here is a demo where we actually deployed a larger cluster with about 50 nodes in soft layer using the same automation. We saw before a demo on OpenStack. We have done the same thing on the cloud in soft layer. And we are starting, you see there are two windows scrolling down there. We actually started two clients. That, for example, on this side, on the left side, we have a window showing starting Swarm containers. On the right side, we are starting Kubernetes pods. And they are represented here. You see these boxes. They are essentially nodes in the cluster. There are 50 of them. And the green icons are essentially Swarm Docker containers. The blue ones are Kubernetes containers. This is a speed up demo, of course. It took about a couple of hours to actually run 10,000 containers and about 1,000 pods in the same cluster. So just to show actually how can we share the same cluster when we run at the same time both Swarm and Kubernetes. And essentially Mesos is managing, as I mentioned earlier, using the resource offer mechanism, the ability to provide now resources to both Swarm and Kubernetes to run this in this particular demo. We also had to do some optimization. This didn't really work completely out of the box, and a lot of the things we actually have done, we also pushed them back to community for Kubernetes and especially Swarm. We had to do some work, in particular on Swarm, to make this work the way we show here. And essentially, at the end of this, we pretty much get 10,000 Swarm containers and 1,000 pods. We didn't start a lot of pods because there are currently some restrictions in the number of pods you can run today for each individual host in Kubernetes to the way the polling is done. So this is pretty much the end of the demo, and I think we have a last chart to finish.
So just to wrap it up, these are the community that we work with. Certainly Magnum, we're very productive in Magnum. Courier to handle the networking, and upcoming we'll handle the support for storage as well. In Mesos, we do have a lot of contribution there. And the Git Mesos, Kubernetes framework for Mesos, and as well as a Swarm framework, right? So these are pretty, a lot of community that we work with to build this kind of environment. If there's any question, we'll be glad to answer them. Please come up to the mic, please.
Is this on?
Yeah.
Yep. Oh, there we go. Yep. I have a question about I understand what Mesos buys me if I'm using Swarm and Kubernetes. If I'm only using one, what does it buy me having Mesos there on top of OpenStack?
Well, indeed, that's why we actually show two frameworks. It's a way, essentially, for me, if I want to share the same large cluster, to have different type of workloads. As I mentioned, we could have run also Spark, for example, together. So the idea is, I have this very large cluster, and then I can deploy different type of workloads. If I'm just running one particular workload, like Swarm Kubernetes by itself, probably Mesos doesn't buy you a lot. Right, because that's pretty much the use we are doing, sharing resources and managing these resources for the workload. Right.
Excellent. All right.
Yes,
thank
you. So this is where Magnum give you the option. If you, just run Kubernetes and nothing else at all in your cluster, then you would just create a cluster for Kubernetes.
Okay. Can I get another one while I'm here?
Sure.
Could I do without OpenStack? What is OpenStack? Absolutely. Give me that I can't get anywhere else.
Sure. So OpenStack, give you the IIS layer, right? So you know, compute, storage, and networking, and so on. So it gives you that support. You can certainly do all of this without OpenStack. There's not required at all. In fact, this is one of the reasons why we developed the Ansible script so that we can run in other cloud, not the OpenStack cloud.
Excellent. Thank you.
For the use case of you're a service provider to a bunch of different groups, can this help us run different workloads, like different containers from two different groups, and assign quotas and things like that?
Multi-tenancy.
Multi-tenancy.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Actually, this is a good question. We actually have done work in community, especially in Swarm. To enable, there is not really multi-tenancy today, but there is a new framework called Auth-Z for authorization that actually we have contributed. In the previous page, there was actually some of the contribution that we are doing in that area. And we have some way today to sort of have some kind of multi-tenancy. There is some additional pieces that is needed, but at least some of the core components are there. For Kubernetes, it's a slightly different story. They actually have already some way to enable that using namespaces. So it's not really multi-tenancy, but it is, there are ways to essentially do some of that. But also Kubernetes provides these emission controllers that allow you to set up things like quota, but you have to do additional work. It's not out of the box like in OpenStack. And Swarm also is not really part of Swarm. If you want things like quota and stuff like that, this all suddenly needs to be added. So we're actually working in this direction with the community to add some of these capabilities to these frameworks.
Okay, the question about we have a kind of very high level quarter concept, like a resource limit, predefined somewhere through the OpenStack or something else. But some of workload sometimes requiring very specific, performance guarantee. Not only I'm going to use a 10 gig disk space, but actually I need to be guaranteed have let's say 200 megabyte per second the writing performance or something like that. So when there is a kind of the storage performance guaranteed or networking side bandwidth guaranteed or latency stuff, if you combine all these possible different variety of workload in this one framework, and the question is that. Right now, is there any way to control such a sophisticated workload through the Mesos framework, or is not still available? Some community is working on that.
So I think, this is a very good question. You're asking about really not just assigning resources, but also guarantee that resource is available. And this actually requires additional pieces. It's not something that Mesos provide you out of the box. We're not actually doing that here. We're not showing that. But there is work in terms of using even Linux cgroups capability or stuff like that to actually be able to actually ensure some of the results. But this is all additional work. It's not something that is already there part out of the box today. Okay. So we actually have some work in that direction, but we're not showing that here.
But to add a little bit to that, the Mesos give you that capability in the sense that it gives you resource offer. And it's up to the scheduler to expect that resource offer and accept it or not. So if you see a resource offer that you don't like, something that doesn't meet your need, then you just reject it and then wait for another one to come along.
Yeah, but the thing is that resource metadata information, whether or not including such a performance guarantee, that's very tricky because if you run some VM on one host that somehow happen to be on the same host, they already contend each other for getting the storage performance, then there is no guarantee. That's right. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you.
So I think we're out of time.
I guess we're out of time.
Right, thank you.
All right, thank you.